I'm Patricia Duff, and I'm so happy to welcome our many call-in audience members and our terrific guest speakers to The Common Good. We have a lot to cover, so we will get right to the conversation, as this one will end promptly at 2:30 today. We're now hitting alarming new numbers as the pandemic surges in hotspots around the country. So we're really especially honored to have Governor Hogan and Secretary Johnson. The popular and independent-minded Governor of Maryland, Larry Hogan, will speak about the pandemic, which the governor has dealt with so effectively in his state, and perhaps we'll have time to touch on other crises facing his state and the nation. Economic worries, as it now looks like we may have to pause recovery in some places, civic unrest and calls for police reform, and an end to systemic racism and other important issues. The governor is a Republican who's been elected twice in the state that is overwhelmingly Democratic. So he's been outspoken, and it's been interesting that he's been outspoken in his criticism about the direction of the president and his own party. He has made tough decisions now with respect to his budget, and we're thrilled to have you, Governor. And to help us out, we are extremely honored to have our good friend, former Secretary of Homeland Security, Jay Johnson, to host and moderate this conversation. Secretary Johnson, whom we're proud to have on our honorary advisory board, of course, ran one of the most complicated and largest agencies in the U.S. government. In recent months, the Secretary has also taken on helping advise Governor Murphy of New Jersey on the COVID response. Thank you both so much for being with the Common Good today. And now I pass the baton to Secretary Johnson to lead our conversation.
Thank you very much, Patricia. Can you hear me?
Absolutely.
Great, great. Governor, thank you very much for your time with us. I think it's also interesting to note that Governor Hogan is a Republican governor in one of the bluest states in the nation, while at the same time enjoying an approval rating that hovers around 70-75%. Last approval rating I saw in the African-American community in Maryland, it's around 70%. Which I think speaks volumes. He is chair of the National Governors Association and has as one of his corporate constituents, a company on whose board of directors I serve, Lockheed Martin. Governor, last time I looked, there are approximately 68,000 COVID cases in the state of Maryland, but the trend lines have all been good. They appear to be good in your state, in terms of rate of hospitalization, rate of new cases, deaths. In your experience, Governor, what has been the key to responding to this horrible situation, and what have been the lessons learned for you as a leader and as a governor during this crisis?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Secretary. It's a real pleasure to see you again and have the chance to talk with you. Patricia, thank you. I appreciate everybody being on to listen to us this afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity. This worldwide pandemic has been unlike anything that I think any of us have ever dealt with. And in your previous capacity, Mr. Secretary, you dealt with a whole lot of different crises. This is one unlike anything I've ever dealt with, not only in my state, but as chairman of the National Governors Association. It really has been the governors all across America on both sides of the aisle who have had to step up and be on the front lines of dealing with this public health crisis paired with this economic crisis both at the same time. And what I did very early on in my state, and this goes back to, we really started looking at this in January, early February, a winter meeting of the NGA when I called in all the top epidemiologists and public health experts in the country to come address the governors. In Maryland put together a coronavirus task force made up of some of the smartest doctors, scientists, places like Johns Hopkins, in our state, and the University of Maryland Medical System, MedStar Health. And we're the headquarters of, the FDA and the NIH here in our state. So we just looked at all the best science and advice from really smart folks. And I took very early and aggressive action. I declared a state of emergency when we got our first case, put in a stay-at-home order in place, and executed 47 different executive orders, taking various actions that I never would have imagined taking. But they helped us to really flatten that curve, saved the lives of a lot of people. And we're doing better than most of the country is at this point. And I say that cautiously, because while we're down more than 80% from our peak, about 84% from our peak 76 days ago, I'm very concerned that we've seen across America a spike in cases of 80% in the past 2 weeks. And we're seeing multiple states move backward on reopenings and take actions to shut things down. So we're concerned about new surges, but so far we've got it pretty much under control. But I'm in conversations with all my fellow governors nearly every day, and I can tell you that people are starting to get much more concerned just in the past couple of weeks.
Governor, what advice would you have for other governors who are seeing a resurgence in their state?
Well, I know that a number of them are have reached out for advice, and I've been in talking with governors one-on-one, both on both sides of the aisle, but also I've chaired 36 different calls like this with all 54 of America's governors of the states and territories, 27 of which had the president and or vice president on the call with his cabinet and the coronavirus task force. So there's been a lot of sharing of information, a lot of sharing of best practices. And I think while there was a difference in how different states reacted and the actions they took, I think it was one of the things I was encouraged by was the amount of bipartisan cooperation and the sharing of information, people really working together with partners in the region, bordering states, and with other folks across the country. But I think what's happening now is people are really, pumping the brakes and or putting things into reverse and watching. We watch on a daily basis these numbers, all of these metrics. We're looking at positivity rates. We're looking at the number of hospitalizations, the number of ICU beds. And if any one of those starts to plateau or starts to go back up instead of down, it's a warning light on the dashboard to say, stop and let's reevaluate. And you've seen a number of states just in the past few days have shut bars and restaurants and movie theaters and a number of other things after they had opened them because of the rapidly rising numbers. We're particularly concerned, and I don't want to get too long on this question, but particularly concerned about young people who are seemingly ignoring the public health advice, many of them gathering in places like bars and nightclubs, and in our state, even though we've been really cautious and careful, our young people under 35 are infected at a rate 55% higher than those over 35, and it's because they're not socially distancing, not wearing masks, and not staying apart from one another.
Here in New Jersey, we're struggling with what to do with public transportation, specifically New Jersey Transit. You have Mark. What's the plan for encouraging people to return to the trains, the commuter trains?
Well, I'd love to get your input on that, as you've been advising Governor Murphy and working on the situation in Jersey. We're dealing not only with the MARC trains, and we have the MTA transit system in Baltimore, but also the Metro system in metropolitan Washington, where we work in conjunction with the mayor of D.C., the federal government, the governor of Virginia, and a number of local jurisdictions, where we fund that and work on it together. We have a lot of people throughout our state, the entire Washington-Baltimore corridor, that typically ride public transportation. Our public transportation ridership is down about 90% from where it had been. We are now trying to get back on some type of more regular schedules because we're trying to get more people safely back into the workplace. We're still encouraging those who can to telecommute. We're still not trying to pack people into, we think it's still a dangerous thing to be on public transportation. So we're unbelievable safety protocols, cleaning, sanitizing, distancing, required masking, capacity restrictions. But it's one of the biggest concerns, and we haven't got all the answers figured out. I can tell you a lot of smart people across the country are, public transportation is one of the biggest concerns. We've got to get people able to get to their jobs but we want to keep them safe while we're doing it.
So you very publicly, along with your wife, and this is obviously the right thing to do for the citizens of Maryland, were able to acquire thousands of test kits. And I wonder what your thought is about what the national level response to that should have been. Aren't things like test kits, PPE, mask, ventilators, things that should be allocated at the national level versus leaving every governor or mayor or hospital to themselves to fend for themselves and acquire these things for themselves?
Well, yes, I believe, I was probably the leading critic. I didn't make the president very happy as a Republican governor, but as the chairman of the National Governors Association, I was speaking up pretty vocally and repeatedly, particularly early on in this crisis when I really felt like the ball was being dropped on testing particularly. And we'll get into those other topics, but there really needed to be a national strategy on testing. And if you remember, we started out saying they had all the tests you could want and anybody that wanted to be tested could be tested, which was absolutely not true. And then they said, we had plenty of testing. And then they shifted the message to testing is a state thing. The governors have to do their own testing, but we're going to provide the testing, which they didn't do. And what you had were 50 states competing on a worldwide market for a very constrained supply with huge demand in the middle of a crisis pandemic. And it was a terrible situation. At the time when my wife was born in South Korea and have a good relationship with the president of South Korea and with the ambassador. And they had done a pretty good job on testing. And we spent almost a month working with them. And my wife speaks fluent Korean back and forth with all of them. We're the Korean company to acquire 500,000 Korean made test kits. And at that time, that was more than the top four states in America had added together. And it was a big step for us, but it shouldn't have had to happen. But we've now caught up on testing, but PPE, they did finally catch up on ventilators by utilizing the Defense Production Act. We had almost none, and they now that's not no longer as big of an issue, but we're still behind on PPE. We're getting ramped up on testing, but many of these, the governors were forced into a position of every man for himself. And through the National Governors Association, we tried to work collaboratively and collectively together with each other and help our neighbors and our colleagues. And the federal government helped in some ways with some pieces of the puzzle, but it definitely could have been done better.
Let me switch subjects on you to the events of Minneapolis and other similar events recently. Governor, what is your thought about the Black Lives Matter movement issue? What has been the reaction in the state of Maryland? And in your judgment, how do we address the issues of excessive force by our nation's law enforcement agencies?
Well, it's obviously, while we're dealing with these other two twin crises of the economic collapse, the worse than the Great Recession, the worst since the Great Depression, and dealing with this worldwide pandemic, which is the biggest we've ever faced. Now in the middle of that, we've got this other kind of crisis and issue in our society that's taken over and caught the focus and attention of everybody in the country with the frustration over the senseless murder of George Floyd, which brought to a head many of these issues that have just been simmering under the surface for a long time. And I can tell you, I was elected governor, I became governor in January of 2015. And 89 days after I became governor, we had riots break out in our largest city of Baltimore with the death of a young man named Freddie Gray. And this was back in the very beginning stages of the Black Lives movement. And so this is not a new thing for us. I think I was maybe one of the first people to deal with this crisis in Baltimore. We had our largest city on fire. 400 some businesses and homes were burned and looted and destroyed, and 27 police and firefighters were injured and hospitalized in the first few hours. And I had to declare a state of emergency. We sent in 4,000 members of the National Guard and 1,000 extra police officers. And we restored peace and calm to the city of Baltimore, kept people safe. We worked together with President Obama and his administration. We allowed people to peacefully protest for a solid week and express their frustrations, but we did not allow violence. We stopped the burning, we stopped the brick throwing, the breaking, the destruction of property, the hurting of people almost immediately within hours. And we were praised for that. You mentioned at the start of the topic, the conversation about my approval rating in the Black community is as high as it is in the white community, or as high as it is with Republicans. I think part of that was how we handled the riots in Baltimore and the Black Lives Matter movement. I walked the streets of Baltimore for a solid week during those riots. I moved our entire operation there. We've tried to address some of these issues for the past 5 years. Now, I'm not saying we've solved them all, but we've certainly tried. We're under a federal consent decree. Baltimore City Police Department is now, we have a Black chief of police. It's 55% minority. We've invested more in recruitment and training and more community policing, de-escalation techniques and training. And so our biggest problem right before this crisis was murders and violent crime in Baltimore City. We've had, since Freddie Gray's death, we've had 1,743 murders in Baltimore City, none of which were involving a police officer. So my concern is that while we address the issue of systemic racism, and while we address the issues of racism, not just in police departments, but in other places across our society, that I don't want to get caught up in this, let's do away with police forces and let's defund police at a time when we desperately need our police. Because I can tell you that the polling we did back in our last legislative session, just before this pandemic and just before this George Floyd situation, 90% of the people in Baltimore City, their number one issue was us doing something about the violent crime and the murders in Baltimore City. We can't do that with fewer police officers and with less money for policing. So we've got to figure out these twin problems, and we've got to work on the racism. We've got to work on police community relations and police training and root out any kind of bad cops and any racism. But I don't think defunding police and taking police out of the places where we have the highest crime is going to solve the issue.
Well, let me ask you a question that I've been asked on television several times in the last month, and I'll admit I've struggled with it a bit. When I'm asked, do you believe there is systemic racism in police departments across the country? How would you answer that, Governor?
I think there's probably systemic racism in nearly every organization across the country. And I don't think police departments are immune from that. But I'll also say that the vast majority of police officers are not racist, and that they work hard every day, putting their lives on the line to keep the rest of us safe. We need to do everything we can to root every single one of the bad cops out. But I want to pay the other cops well and train them well and thank them and reward them for the great job that they do for the rest of us.
Okay. One last question from me. This is not an easy one. Maryland was a slave state. In fact, my mother's maiden name is Edlin. Her ancestors were slaves in Charles County, Maryland, on the Edlin tobacco farm there. I've read that there are some in Maryland who want to take down statues of Christopher Columbus in Baltimore. There's a move, as you know, to take the names of Confederate generals off of army bases across the South, to take down statues of Robert E. Lee. On the other hand, you know, George Washington was a slave owner. I have first cousins named Washington. They're quite proud of their name. They're not changing their name. It's a quintessential American name. So where do you think the where do you think the line should be drawn? How far should we go in reassessing our history and taking the names of those aligned with the Confederacy, with slave ownership, off of buildings, statues, currency? Where would you draw the line?
Well, that's a hard question to come up with, Jay. I mean, you probably left me with a tough one. I'd love to sit down and have that discussion with you to figure it out. But obviously, there are certain people that, you know, I thought it was a terrific move, by the way, that Mississippi finally took the Confederate flag off of their state flag. That was after 150 years. It's about time to see that happen. Certainly, when you talk about some of the things that are so offensive, several years ago, after I became governor, we removed a tawny statue that was here outside of our state house, which was, you know,
Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. He was on the Dred Scott opinion.
Exactly. Chief Justice of the Supreme Court on the Dred Scott opinion, which was a racist decision. It was offensive to so many people in our state. And I agreed that he didn't deserve to have recognition here. We made a vote of the State House Trust, which was made up of the President of the Senate, the Speaker of the House, and myself, represented by the Lieutenant Governor, who's African American, by the way, to make the decision to remove that statue. We also have portraits of George Washington and all of our founding fathers here in the State House, and Lord Baltimore, and every portrait hanging in our State House, every single person here, I think, was a slave owner. So you can't erase history, and we can't go back and pretend as if none of these things happened. We just took a plaque down off the State House wall just a week or so ago. That was a plaque dedicated to soldiers that fought in the Civil War, and it wasn't picking sides on the Civil War, but it had both flags there. And the Speaker of the House, an African-American woman, raised the issue that it was offensive. And again, the State House Trust took a vote and unanimously decided that it wasn't right to have that plaque in this building. And so we took it down. But what I'm opposed to is, gangs of people taking it upon themselves in a lawless way to go out and just tear down public property and the destruction of government-owned property. If people feel strongly about something, I think they need to go through the proper channels and get those votes and convince people to have the decisions made. But I don't think we can go back and take down every single one of the portraits of all the founding fathers who were all slave owners. I mean, I think that's a bridge too far.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Well, those are very
Patricia,
thoughtful,
over to you.
Very thoughtful responses. We do have a question from Jill Iskell, which I want to get to in a minute, but I want to ask you, Governor, are you concerned? You have expressed concern about the direction of the Republican Party, perhaps the direction of politics in general, hyper-partisanship. And are you as concerned about it as ever and as we enter this election season?
I'm probably more concerned about it than ever. It's really why I ran for office, frankly. I'm a lifelong businessman who never held office before. In 2014, I just got so frustrated with what was going on in our state, I decided to run in a state that was almost completely Democratic. And I got Democrats and independents and Republicans to support me and then reelect me because I'm not a very partisan guy, but I really just want to, I think what most people in America are looking for are just people that will work together in a common sense, bipartisan way to solve the problems. And I think most people are not really as partisan as the folks that are the most active. They're not far left or far right, and they're not necessarily looking for this divisiveness and dysfunction. They just want things solved. And so I am frustrated with where my party's heading. I'm frustrated with where the Democratic Party is heading too. And I think we're heading on a course where both parties are going to have to re-examine themselves. And I think regardless of what happens in November, we're going to have to look at things differently over the next 4 years because I think our political system is broken. I think it can be fixed, but I think we've got a lot of work to do. And I think most Americans are completely frustrated with the process and completely frustrated with divisiveness and dysfunction and the political process. And they don't feel like either party nominates the best candidate for the job in most elections.
Thank you. That's so thoughtful and so true. I think we have time. Oh, I don't even think we have time for a couple more questions. Jill Iskell, do you want to go next? She may have be having trouble turning on her.
Okay, I'm here. Governor, thank you so much. This has been extraordinary to listen to you and Jay Johnson be so thoughtful and candid about the state of affairs in this country. I'm just curious about how you're dealing with reopening the schools in Maryland.
Yeah, it's probably one of the hardest things for us to figure out. Luckily, we've got really smart people. We've got a wonderful state superintendent of schools, Karen Salmon, who has a great team of people working for the state Board of Education and working in conjunction with all of our local boards of education and getting their input. They're trying to go about it in a safe way. And a lot of it has to do with what we're going to be experiencing at the time when schools come back, but they're prepared for any number of, they've got to leave some flexibility in it based on where the numbers are. Assuming that we're continuing to trend in the direction we are, they've got some really good plans for reopening schools in a safe way with kind of staggered time frames, kids going to school, half the school going half the day, the other half going the second half of the day, smaller classrooms, distancing and safety and protocols and temp checks and all some distance learning, but being in the classroom, doing more work at home. It's a very involved, detailed plan that they've put together with flexibility for different jurisdictions. And we've invested a lot of money, including Federal CARES Act money, into more technology and the ability to do more distance learning and rural broadband and urban broadband and being able to help kids. But it's our biggest challenge, I think. We've got to get kids back to school, but we have to really do it in a way that keeps them safe.
Thank you.
Thank you. We've got Jeffrey Rosen. You have a question?
Governor, thank you very much for your presentation. I've come back to your comment about the Republican Party having to rethink itself, is the way I think of it. If you were in charge of that rethinking process, what do you think the Republican Party should stand for? And perhaps either on its own or by comparison to the Democratic Party?
Well, so I'm a lifelong Republican, and I guess I came of age, or I was coming out of college around the time of Ronald Reagan. And, you know, I'm a guy who believed that the country ought to be standing with our allies and standing up for our allies. I believe in free market and growing our economy and smaller government, but providing better services. I believe in a big tent. You know, I've been really successful here in reaching out and reaching across the aisle. And as Jay mentioned at the beginning, you know, I have the same approval ratings with independents and Democrats and Republicans and black voters and white voters and women and men and young voters and old voters. So I think not narrowing the base. Right now, I think the Republican Party is shrinking and appealing to less and less groups of people. It's almost like a pup tent. I believe in a much bigger tent with a lot, you know. I don't think we have to have a rigid ideology. You stand up for what you believe in and the general principles of free enterprise, of peace through strength, of working with our allies, and providing a better, more efficient government and without getting into divisive arguments, with, you know, to find a way to reach common ground and find that middle ground where we can all come together. I think, you know, compromise is not a dirty word, and reaching agreement to get things done. I'm a kind of a get to work and get things done kind of a Republican, where I'll work with anybody if we can get the people's business done. And I think that's really what both parties ought to be trying to do.
Well, you've certainly done a great job of doing that, Governor, and we really admire your effectiveness over the last several months. It's So I want to thank you so much for being with us today. And Jay, you're just a gem to help us with this. So happy to have you both here. Governor, I think you've got a big future, so we hope we see you again. You've got a lot on your plate, and it's important.
Well, Patricia, thank you very much. Jay, thank you, and I appreciate the opportunity very much. I hope everybody has a great 4th of July holiday weekend. Stay safe.
Thank you, Governor. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Oh, got Jay? Are you out the door?
I'm here.
We had one question. I said to Stan Cohen, he could ask it when we were done. You want to ask it, Stan?
Okay, I'm here. Secretary, my question was, how do we get Michelle Obama to be the vice president with Biden?
I happen to know that Michelle Obama has absolutely no interest in becoming a politician. If you'd like me to make a prediction about who he's going to select to be his running mate, I predict Tammy Duckworth.
Really?
Do you think that's partly because of that Frank Bruni article the other day, or was that in the works before?
I think the Frank Bruni article is reflective of a gathering momentum for Tammy Duckworth, and I think she'd be an inspired choice.
Yeah. We've had her as the common good. She's terrific.
Yep. I think Tammy Duckworth would be terrific. I also like Val Demings, Congresswoman from Florida. She's not as well known, but she's got a law enforcement background, and she's from a swing state, obviously. I predict, based on nothing except intuition and the ability to read the political winds, that Tammy Duckworth will be the choice, but don't know that for sure.
Well, that's a fabulous prediction. Really interesting, coming from somebody who worked in the Obama administration and certainly knows Joe Biden well, too. So appreciate that. I just want to let everyone know who's on. We do have a lot of great things coming up. Neil Katyal, the terrific attorney and author with Kay Koplowitz. Sarah Longwell, who started, she's been a Never Trumper Republican and is raising Cain with a lot of advertising that's anti-Trump at the moment. Tom Rogers is going to be on with his daughter, Jessica. He's going to talk about slowing down the takeover of society by social media and how we do that. We've got Congressman Eric Swalwell with Dennis Meehl, and a lot of other really interesting things. But Jay, thank you so much. We so appreciate it. Right, everybody? Thank you. Hope to see you soon in person one of these days.
Okay.
All right. Take good care.
Take
care. Goodbye, everybody. Thank you again.